ॐ सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सहवीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः यो अन्तः प्रविश्य मम वाच इमां प्रसुप्तां सञ्जीवयति अखिलशक्तिधरस्वदाम्नाम् अन्यांश्च हस्तचरणश्रवणत्वगादीन् प्राणान्नमो भगवते पुरुषाय तुभ्यं लसतु श्रीमदानन्दतीर्थेन्दुर्णो हृदम्बरे यद्वचश्चन्द्रिका स्वान्तसन्तापं विनिकृन्तति पदवाक्यप्रमाणज्ञान् प्रणम्य शिरसा गुरून् व्याकरिष्ये यथा बोधं विष्णुतत्त्वविनिर्णयम्. ओके, गुड् आफ्टर्नून् फोक्स्. सो वेल्कम् टु द थर्ड् सेशन् आन् Katha Upanishad. I think we're going to have a very interesting discussion over the next one and a half hours. I think there's lots to cover for this particular session. But anyway, let's see how time takes us. So let's get into the Upanishad. Harihi Om Ushan Havai Vajashravasaha Sarvavedasam Dadau Tasyahana Nachiketo Nama Putra Asa तम्ह कुमारं संतं दक्षिणासु नियमानाशु श्रद्धा विवेश सो अमन्यत पीतोदका दग्धतृणा दुग्धद्रोहा निरिन्द्रियाः अनन्दा नामते लोकाः तान् स गच्छति ताददत् सहोवाच पितरं तत कस्मै मां दास्यसि इति द्वितीयं तृतीयं तं होवाच मृत्यवे त्वा ददामिति बहुनामेपि प्रथमो बहुनामेमि मध्यमः किं स्विद्यमस्य कर्तव्यं यन्मयादद्य करिष्यति अनुपश्य यथा पूर्वे प्रतिपश्य तथा परे सस्यमिव मर्त्यः पच्यते सस्यमिव जायते पुनः वैश्वानरः प्रविशति अतिथिर्ब्राह्मणो गृहान् तस्य एतां शान्तिं कुर्वन्ति हर वैवस्वत उदकम् आशा प्रतीक्षे संगतं सुनृतां च इष्टा पूर्ते पुत्र पशुं च सर्वान् एतद् वृङ्क्ते पुरुषस्य अल्पमेधसा यस्य अनश्नन् वसति ब्राह्मणो गृहान् तीस्रो रात्रीः यदवस्तीः गृहे मे अनश्नन् ब्रह्मन् अतिथिर् नमस्यः नमस्ते अस्तु ब्रह्मन् स्वस्ति मे अस्तु तस्मात् प्रति त्रीन् वरान् वृणुष्व शान्तसङ्कल्पः सुमनाः यथा स्यात् वीतमन्युः गौतमो मा अभिमृत्योः त्वत् प्रसृष्टं मा अभिवदेत् प्रतीतः एतत् त्रयाणां प्रथमं वरं वृणे यथा पुरस्ताद् भविता प्रतीतः औद्धालकी आरुणिः मत्प्रतिष्ठः सुखं रात्रीः शयिता वीतमन्युः त्वां ददृश्यवान् मृत्युमुखात् प्रमुक्तम्. सो दिस् इस् वाट् वि कवर्ड् द लास्ट् टू सेशन्स्. सो द वर्सस् ऐ जस्ट् ट्रै टु रिसैट् द वर्स् इन् क्विक् सक्सेशन् बट् लेट्स् नाट् स्पेण्ड् टू मच् टैम् बिकास् यु आर् आल् वेरि फेमिलियर् वित् द काण्टेक्स्ट् हियर्. सो द काण्टेक्स्ट् इस् जस्ट् टु रिमैण्ड् यु उद्दालकारुणि वास् गिविङ्ग् अवे यूस्लेस् कौस् टु गेस्ट् हु हड् अराइव्ड् टु हिस् आश्रम. Nachiketa saw all this and said, what kind of charity are you doing? You are doing charity so that you are doing this Vishwajit Yajna, which is a big Yajna, which is associated with charity. And what is the charity that you give? You give all the wealth that you have. And what is that? Ushan Havai Vajashravasahar. You were desirous of going to Swargaloka to enjoy heavenly things in existence. And to do that, you're doing Vishwajit Yajna and you're giving away all your wealth. But what kind of wealth are you giving dad? You're giving all these useless cows, and he pesters him three times and his dad curses him, or he just gets irritated and he flips and he said, Mrutyave Tvad Dadamiti. And that's how the philosophy starts. And Nachiketa is now taking you. It is a vision for Nachiketa. We spent a lot of time talking about the vision for Nachiketa. So this is a vision. He falls down when his father says, Mrutyave Tva Dadamiti. And then the vision that he gets is that he is actually making the journey to Yamaloka. He is one among the infinite number of souls that are following him or will follow him. And the infinite number of souls are in front of him and he is in the middle. So he has got this kind of picturization of how it is. And this is the this is the reality of life. And Krishna, if you remember, in that Vishwarupa Yoga, he says all these beings, Arjuna says, all these beings are entering into him like they're going into his mouth and so on. So that is the kind of picturization that Nachiketa is giving, that all these souls are going towards Yamaloka and I'm just one among those. And when he goes there, when he is on his route, then the Yamadutas tell him, look at all these jivas, how they are all suffering in Naraka. So we saw quite a lot of philosophy around Anupashya Yata Purve Pratipashya Tata Pare Sasyamiva Martyaha Pachyate Sasyamiva Jayate Punaha. Profound philosophy conveyed through the Yamadutas, where they have this discussion and ask Nachiketa to see this journey of souls. What are these souls experiencing? And then he goes to Nachiketa's, he goes to Yama's palace. Shyamala Devi initially welcomes him and asks him to come inside and have some water and food. Nachiketa refuses that and he says, I will wait for 3 nights because I have come here to meet Yama and nobody else. And so following 3 nights, then Yama gives darshan to him. And then Yama is very respectful. And at that point, we saw about how to treat an atithi, how to treat a guest. And what are all the problems if we don't treat our guests properly? What are all the sins or the problems that we incur? That was discussed in last week. And then our teacher Yama is very impressed with Nachiketa and he says, you waited for 3 nights, so I shall give you 3 boons. And the first boon, immediately Nachiketa says, you know what, give my dad correct buddhi. Now let him calm down. Let me go back eventually to the same body that I left so that my dad is able to recognize me. He's happy to see me. He will talk to me nicely and so on. And Yama says, so be it. Yeah, when you go back, when you wake up, when you stand up, your dad will recognize you. He'll be very happy to see you. He will never get angry again. And he will be able to have good sleep every night because he's very peaceful and contented with himself. So that is the first vara, that first boon that Nachiketa asks and Yama gives that boon. So today what we will do over the next 10 to 12 slides is try and tackle, at least let's do half of the second boon that is being given. So how does the second boon start? So our friend Nachiketa, then he talks to Yama. This is the conversation he says. He says, Swarge loke nabayam kinchanasti, natatratvam na jaraya bibeti, ube tirtva ashana pipase, shokadiko modate swargaloke. So these are very, very clear statements as to what is it that our friend Nachiketa is indicating here. So the first set of words that we need to look at to understand the context here is swargaloka. So this verse, Nachiketa is saying, he starts off with swargaloka and he finishes off with swargaloka. So we need to think about this problem because the evidence as to what that swargaloka is in between these two beginning and the end of sentences. Whatever is being said here should give us a clue as to what is that swargaloka that Nachiketa is asking for. Remember, Nachiketa is asking for a swargaloka. Do you think he's going to ask for the same swargaloka that his dad has been asking for to do the Vishwajit Yajna? Yeah. Will he be asking the same swargaloka where he'll go and have good time for several hundreds of years, you know, dance with the dancers and eat and drink and make merry? Is that what he's going to ask for, or he's asking something else? Yeah. So we need to think about the context here. That will make it very clear as to what type of swargaloka or swarga that Nachiketa is asking. Okay. So let's look at the etymology of swargaloka. We briefly touched upon this last time. Swarga is swa plus ra plus ga. Swa means what? Swayam, swa, me. Okay. Ramanam means bliss. Gamayati, attains. Okay. So in the deepest sense, in what we call as a parama mukhya vritti, swarga actually means attaining moksha or liberation. It is not this temporary swarga that Nachiketa is talking about here. So I'm just giving you a prelude to that, and I'll put the arguments forwards as to why Nachiketa is asking for that. The first argument I've said is he's not stupid enough to be asking the same Swargaloka that his dad asked for. He's going to ask for something different. Okay. Now look at the next word. Nabayam kincha nasti. So he's saying, you know that Swargaloka where there is no fear. Okay. Which Swargaloka has no fear? Okay. So let's think about this. If it was Indraloka, and if I'm going to go to Indraloka and spend there, you know, how many ever hundreds of thousands of years, I always have the fear. Okay. I will always have the fear that I have to come back to Mrityuloka after I have exhausted all my punyas. Okay. So that is what is the Shastras talk about. When you go to Swargaloka, you come back to Mrityuloka after you have exhausted all your punyas. So the jivas who are there in Swargaloka, believe me, although they seem to be enjoying, they still have that fear that eventually they'll have to come back. Okay. So, but what is that Swargaloka that Nachiketa is talking about? Nabayam kincha na asti. There is no fear in that Swarga. Now the next one, I have underlined the next one, and it's, this is very, very interesting and funny actually. And he says, natatratvam. So if you think about that scene, Nachiketa is actually pointing his hand and says, you are also not there, mate. Teacher, you are also not there in that Swargaloka. Natatratvam is what Nachiketa is saying. In that Swarga, even you are not there, or even your influence is not there. Okay, so this is an important statement that sometimes when I see these transliterations that are written up, I really feel sad that people don't read these texts very carefully, because here it says natatratvam. What does that mean? In that Swarga, Yama is not there, or Yama's influence is not there. Okay, Yama is in Swargaloka. Okay, the lokas of Indra and all the Devata lokas are all together forms the Swargaloka. Yama is very much in this material Swargaloka. But Nachiketa is saying, natatratvam, Guru, you are also not there. Okay. Then he says, na jaraya bibeti. Bibeti means fear. Jaraya means old age. So na jaraya bibeti. In that Swarga, there is no fear of old age. Okay. Then the next one, ashanaya pipase ube tirtva. So that means, in that world, you've gone beyond hunger and thirst. Okay, so that is very, very interesting. Hunger and thirst. And it also says ube. So in Sanskrit, just wanted to remind, there is singular, there is dual, and there is plural. Sanskrit is the only language where you have singular, dual, and plural. Okay. So in English, it is singular and plural. Yeah. But here in this sentence is interesting, where it says ashanaya pipase is dual. There are two. But again, Nachiketa says ube, two. Tirtva means crossed. So what does that mean is the hunger and thirst. So the hunger and thirst is an important concept for all of us, because we are mortal beings, right? We have two types of hunger and thirst. One is the material hunger and thirst to feed this body. The gross body that we have, we feed it. And how do we feed it? When we are hungry, we feed it. And when we are thirsty, we drink it. We drink water, etc. So that is one type of ashana and pipase. But there is a second type of ashana and pipase that is for the mind. Mind is hungry about something. Mind is always thirsty for knowledge. Yeah. So those sort of things are also there for the mind. So this is very important concept that Krishna also talks about in Gita, that there are two types of hunger and thirst. One is for the gross body and the other one is for the mind. And Nachiketa says, both these things are not there in that world. You neither have the material hunger or craving, or the mind hunger and craving, which means that you're fully contented and satisfied and you don't need anything else. That means you have attained your liberation. Okay. Shokatigo, no fear of sorrow. There is no sorrow there at all. So moksha is not just the elimination of sorrow, but it is also positive experience of bliss. So immediately Nachiketa says, shokatigo modate. Okay, Swargaloke. So modate means what? Enjoys. Swaramanam. Swargaloke. So the statements are very, very clear with regards to what Nachiketa is asking for. He is asking Yama, Can you teach me that knowledge by knowing which I will actually transit the temporary Swargaloka and I'll actually jump on to this permanent Swargaloka, which is also called Vaikuntha or Moksha. So this is what Nachiketa is seeking from Yama. What is that knowledge that I need? With that knowledge, equipped with that knowledge, I can actually jump over from the temporary Swargaloka eventually to a permanent eternal Swarga or Vaikuntha or Moksha, which is the second boon that Nachiketa is asking. And this is very important for us to hold on to that idea, because unless you understand this concept, the next verse will actually not make a lot of sense. Okay, so there is also another view that the journey of souls, and that is where it becomes important, when the souls make the journey upwards and onwards, they initially go to the temporary Swargaloka and they spend some time in the Swargaloka. Then they go to Satyaloka and from there they wait until the dissolution of the universe and then they cross over to the non-material plane. So that is the journey of souls that we have been talking about all along for the last 2 years in this forum. But the Swargaloka, the Parama Mukhya Vruti, as I called it, the basic sense of Swarga is actually Moksha, from where Nachiketa comes from. Okay, so hold on to that thought. Swarge Loke Nabayam Kinchanasti Natatratvam Najaraya Bibeti Ube Tirtva Ashanaya Pipase Shokatigo Modate Swargaloke. Okay, so then he goes on, then he says, Swatvam Agnim Swargyam Adyeshi Mrityoho Prabruhi Tvam Shraddhadanaya Mahyam. So that's the next word. So Nachiketa, this is a conversation, right, between Nachiketa and Yama. So Nachiketa initially said, look, I want to go to that Swargaloka where there is no fear of death, there is no fear of old age, there is no fear of sorrow, there is no hunger and thirst there, and there is an eternal attainment of bliss. So I want to go to that Swargaloka. Then he also tells Yama, Saha Swargyam, sorry, let me go to this next line. My IT is playing up. Saha Tvam Agnim Swargyam. So you need to look at that word carefully. So what that means is, Saha means that Swargyam, Tvam Agnim. Agnim means what? He says, you know, to go to that Swarga, you need to know about this Agni. Yeah. And this Agni, you know very well, Yama, he says, Adyeshi Mrityoho. So you know about the Agni, that about which we should know, which will lead us to Moksha. So what does that mean? Let's think about that a bit more. Yeah. So again, as I said, context becomes important when you understand what is it that the Upanishad is talking about. So what was happening on earth? Our friend Nachiketa was watching what his dad Uddalaka was doing. What was Uddalaka doing? Uddalaka was doing Vishwadit Yajna. What is that Yajna? Yajna is there is a kunda, there is a fire, then you recite some mantras and then you throw something inside it. That's the kind of Yajna that is going on. Okay. But his dad was doing an Yajna, a fire sacrifice that will lead him to temporary Swarga. But what Nachiketa is asking here is, I don't want to know about that Agni sacrifice. I want to know about the different higher level Agni sacrifice that you know about, Yama, very well. Teach me that Agni sacrifice by which I can actually go to Moksha. Okay. So that Agni there is very interesting and it's a fascinating discussion. So I want to spend a lot of time talking about this Agni today and nail this in our head as to what that fire or what that Agni actually means in Sanatana Dharma. Because we all go to the temples, we do this havan, we go to marriages, we go to all the rituals, we see some fire, somebody throwing something. All this is happening with nobody actually understanding what is going on there. It has all become so superficial, so ritualistic. It has become so ritualistic with no purpose. Okay, but that is not what our friend Nachiketa is asking Yama. He is asking, what is the philosophy behind this Agni Yajna? What is the philosophy between the fire sacrifice? Because I want to know that. I want to know the purpose of it. Yeah. Just to remind you, in Vedas, the whole of Vedas gives us the right knowledge. That is called Paravidya. But when we don't understand the inner truths of what, for example, Ajurveda is a Veda of Yajana. Yeah, there's a lot of rituals and fire sacrifices that is described in the Ajurveda. Now, this is all, if you look at it from an Aparavidya angle without us having the right approach, it becomes very ritualistic. But that is not what the Yajurveda is all about. There is nothing called Karmakanda in the Vedas. That is a misnomer. It becomes a Karmakanda when we are not equipped properly to understand the Vedas. Then it becomes Karmakanda. But the whole of the Vedas is only Jnanakanda. Because Krishna has very clearly told us, isn't it? Sarve Veda, Yama himself says this, but Krishna says, Vedaishta Sarveer Ahameva Vedyaha. Yeah, so Krishna has made it very categorical. The mistake is on our part of not understanding it and superficially classifying it into Karmakanda and Jnanakanda, which for some schools is totally unacceptable. Every word, letter and sound in the Vedas only give us the knowledge about the Supreme is the declaration of the Vedas. And that is what Nachiketa is asking here. I don't want to know about the ritualistic Agni sacrifice. I want to know about what is the proper fire sacrifice. And you know about that very well, Yama. Explain it to me. Okay. So I hope that background that I've given is useful. Because let's think about this Agni a bit more. And I want to bring in some interactions here. So Agni, I'll just give a initial basics and then we'll take it up from there. So what is Agni? So fire. Yeah. So this fire is Agni. So you have the material fire that we all see when a havan happens in a temple. Then, of course, our Vedas talk about various other Agnis. You have Pradhana Agni, the main Agni Devata, who is the 15th rank of the Vedic pantheon. Now, if you remember the Chandogya Upanishad, when we did Tejas Aap Annam and how they do creation, we spoke about Agni. So go back to those Chandogya Upanishad lectures and have a think about it. Because Agni can also mean Kala Agni Rudra. Agni can also mean Prana Agni, Chaturmukha or Mukhya Prana. Or Agni can also mean Kala Agni Durga. So there are so many Agnis in Vedic scriptures. And then, of course, this power, this Pradhana Agni has got empty number of kids. He's got 49 kids. I mean, 49 below him. So there are so many Agnis that are discussed in our Vedic scripture. Material Agni, Pradhana Agni, Kala Agni Rudra, Prana Agni, Chaturmukha, Kala Agni Durga. And then there is the Agni Narayana. So these are all the various individuals that come in the fire sacrifice. So when you read the Yajurveda or when you do the prescriptions for particular yajna that is described in the Yajurveda, you should watch it very, very carefully because and that is where the rules of interpretations of the Vedas come in. Unfortunately, if you don't do that, then it looks like it is all very ritualistic. Yeah, so we should be very careful in avoiding that approach of being solely ritualistic without understanding the deeper philosophy of that. So what I'll do is over the next 30-40 minutes, hopefully I'll be able to impress upon you what is that fire sacrifice that Nachiketa is talking about. So I've got a few questions here. What is the role of symbols in Vedic philosophy? Yeah, if God is non-material, how can we use material symbols to worship? Is it not self-contradictory? After all, there is a big sutra by Vedavyasa, our founding father, which declares categorically that this Brahman is Om Arupavadevahi Tat Pradhanatva. So this chap is so beyond matter. He has transcended matter that he doesn't have any material forms at all. He is beyond matter is what Vedavyasa has said in the Vedanta Sutra. So if that is the case, how can we use symbols? Yeah. So this is supposed to be a bit provocative for today's discussion because that is one of the arguments that comes from other religions that Hindus are idolaters. They worship idols, they worship symbols, but actually God is beyond all this. So how do you square this circle? If somebody asks you, you guys are idol worshippers, how are you going to address that? Okay, so I think this discussion, this conversation with Nachiketa and Yama gives us a good forum to think about this problem. Okay, so I'm going to sip a couple of, I'm going to have some water here, but I'm going to just open this up for discussion. If God is non-material, how can we use material symbols? Okay, do we have any initial thoughts on that, please? Any contribution, Sudarshan? Sushrut, anybody?
I feel they are like codes, codes, and you break open the code and then you start contemplating on it. Any code for that matter, even any code, when you see, you just, it makes you think, what is it behind? Even like even a DNA, for example, it is coded, and then how it comes out. So maybe that way.
Yeah, thank you, Pratibhaji. Anybody else wants to put in their ideas here, please?
Madhu Suresh.
Oh, hi, Suresh. Yes, go for it.
Yeah, perhaps God is beyond material, but we cannot perceive what's beyond material. Therefore, we need a medium, and we are expected to appreciate the presence of the non-material in the material symbols that we use. So it's a media for us to perceive what we can't. And that's why the symbolism is how I would understand it.
Thank you so much, Suresh. Very well put. Anybody else has any other views here? Okay. Yeah.
I think, I mean, I don't know other religions that much, but in Christianity, they say that God has made man in image of himself. And why would God do that? I think they then would, that would imply that that image is material, isn't it? I don't know.
Yeah.
It makes
Okay.
it easier to meditate upon if there is a form, I think.
Thank you, Devalji. So diverse views here. So I think one thing that I need to say, and I need to break the ice here or bite the bullet, however you want to say, I want to make it very clear. Vedic philosophy prohibits idol worship. Okay, full stop. Vedic philosophy prohibits symbol worship as God himself or herself. That is very clear from Vedic philosophy. The reason why I say that is, it's not my view, it is a view of Vedavyasa. It is a view of our founding father, the person who has compiled the Vedas, who is Narayana's incarnation himself. In Vedanta Sutra, this is a very, very important sutra, 414. Just check this out. Na pratike nahi saha. This is the Vedanta Sutra's declaration. Na pratike na sah na nahi saha. Pratika means what? Pratika means symbols. Yeah, symbols, material symbols. Okay. So, what is it that Vedavyasa is talking to us today about this? What does the sutra actually means? I think Suresh got this, the concepts spot on. So, let's look at Panchabhutas. Yeah. So, you have sky, air, earth, fire, and water. So this is what the Panchabhutas that we have. And as Suresh was mentioning, we are very limited mortal beings. Our soul, we as souls, our capacity for knowledge, our capacity to understand bigger stuff is limited. Yeah, we got to accept that. So what we do in our mundane lives is, with whatever material things that we have around us, we try to form some symbols. So that we use that symbol to understand that there is perhaps some subtle truth underneath this. And I think that is what Pratibha Ji was getting at by saying code. Yeah, there is a code with all this, and we need to understand the code underneath this. Yeah, rather than taking the code itself as God, actually understanding what that code means. Okay, so that is a very interesting way of looking at it. So if you look at Earth, Earth is the grossest, yeah. The solid state is the grossest form of matter that we know. So, what are the things that we have at our disposal? We can have wood, we can have stones, we can have gems, or various types of metals. Okay. So, what do? We take wood and we carve a Vishnu's vigraha, or a stone, or a quartz, or some gems. And then metals, various types of metals. You can have silver, gold, bronze, all sorts of combinations, and you can do various vigrahas. Okay, so that we can do as symbols. Now, here I have to say, this use of symbols is not unique to the Sanatana Dharma. Every religion in the world actually uses symbols one form or the other. Okay, they may not overtly recognize that. They may not overtly say we use symbols to understand deeper truths. They may not. That is their problem. But for us, we accept symbols are required as a medium to understand hidden truths. For a symbol is openly accepted fact. For other religions, they do it all the time without naming anybody. They do it all the time, but somehow they don't recognize. Okay. Now, why do we use the symbols? Now, there is a very, very important verse in Taittiriya Upanishad, and we have done this before. It goes like this. So akamayat bahusyam prajayeya iti satapo atapyata sataptva idam sarvam asrujata. Yadidam kincha tat srushtva tadeva anupravishata. So this is the most important word there. Tat srushtva tadeva anupravishata. Okay, so that is a key point. This Upanishad talks about how creation comes about. And even in Chandogya Upanishad, we have done that. So the unique concept of Sanatana Dharma and the creatorship of the Supreme Being is that the Supreme Being not only uses the material thing, that is the Jada Prakriti or the Mula Prakriti, to bring forth the modification of the gross world. But everything that gets modified, he actually pervades into his creation. And when he pervades into this creation, he gives that created object its reality, its objecthood of knowledge, and its ability to do something. This is called Satta, Pramiti and Pravriti. So he does three things to all objects. So if you have that concept, then when I look at a stone in a temple, I will never think that that stone is God. But what I will be thinking, because Taittiriya Upanishad has said that and Vedavyasa has said that, I'll be thinking, look, this particular vigraha is permeated by the Supreme Being, because it is a creation of the Supreme. It has pervaded. The Supreme Being is pervaded in the stone. And when I look at the stone, it is beautiful to me and it reminds me of certain great characteristics of the Supreme. And that is the reason why I would go and worship the stone in a temple. Okay, so that is the philosophy behind earth and the various things that you get from earth. That is, the statues made of wood, stone, gems, and metals, they're all the same because they're all made of one form of the earth or another. But if you have this concept underneath, and if you are able to communicate to our fellows, our friends in other religions, this problem would have never arisen of Hindus as idolaters, which is most unfortunate. But it is our own mistake because we don't ourselves recognize this is the way of doing worship of deities. We don't recognize that and we are not able to articulate that to our friends in other religions. So what I would sincerely hope is that we think about this problem a bit more so that we are able to tell everybody, friends, we are all on the same book on this. There is no contradiction here. We are all agreeing that the Supreme Being is beyond matter. That is a given. But we also agree the stone is not the Supreme Being. He is transcendent. Yeah, Sahasrashi, our Purusha Shukta has categorically said that. And this sutra, Arupava Devahi Tat Pradhanvatvat, is very clear. But we should tell them, we just use this as a symbol so that it reminds us of certain aspects of the greatness of the Supreme. Okay, so hold on to that idea of something that reminds us about the great attributes of the Supreme. So earth is one symbol that we use. We don't use air in our worship because air we can't see. It doesn't have a form, right? We cannot see air. So we are not able to make some symbol out of air and worship it. Sky, for example, we don't have a form. We can't make a shape for sky and say, look, we want to worship because we are limited beings. We need something that we can use to understand the unlimited. So sky is also not a great symbol. Let's look at water. Water is so fluid. I don't know what form that you can create so that you can worship water. So water is also not a great symbol that we use. Although, you know, in deep philosophy, God has permeated air, God has permeated sky, God has permeated water, fire, and earth. So you can view it like that, but that's for exalted beings. We are mere mortals looking at this problem in a very gross sense, with our limited understanding. So water we don't use. So we have two at our disposal. One is fire and another one is earth. In the Vedic times and also now, these two have remained key forms of symbols of worship. Yeah, not only in Sanatana Dharma, but there are also other religions who do this. And I'll come to that. I've got a slide on that. Yeah. So now let us take water, earth, and fire. So which among the three, although God is pervaded in all the three, which among the three is pure or is more suitable for contemplation of Brahman? Okay. So is earth and the forms of earth that we can make is the most suitable symbol for contemplation of Brahman, or fire is the most suitable symbol for contemplation of Brahman? What are our views on this before I go to the next slide? Any views? What do we think? Would somebody prefer to worship a deity made of wood, or would rather do a fire sacrifice, a havan, for example?
Madhu, fire is always pure. It is impossible to contaminate fire. So in that way, it probably is the purest form of worship.
Thank you, Shushut. Well done. Prakneshji, you raised your hands.
Yeah, I want to differ here slightly. Fire is purer, I completely agree, but it is not easily manageable. So it is commoner practice to use earth as a symbol for day-to-day practice.
Yeah, very good, Prakash. Very well put again. So, yeah.
Can I come in here? There is also slight difference. I don't know in cultural practices. So, for example, where I come from, the cultural practices, when it is sunset, you have to have a place in the olden days, probably, where the pot containing water is kept. And there is always, you do Sandhya Vandana and Aarti in the home temple, but we always put a fire near that water. So sort of there is a prayer there as well. Yeah.
Okay, that's interesting. So that's interesting. Water and fire. Thanks, Devalji. So yeah. So which is the most suitable? Yeah, Prakneshji's view is very pragmatic with regards to what is more practical. Okay. So point taken, Prakneshji. But still, the question remains: what is the most suitable symbol for contemplation of Brahman? What did our Vedic rishis think about it? So we are talking about, Upanishads, right? So let's see what the Vedic rishis view about what is the most suitable symbol for contemplation of Brahman can be in the next slide. Okay. So again, I say Sahatvam Agnim Swargyam Adyeshi Mrityoho. So we are still talking about this fire. So the declaration of the Vedic rishis is, although from Prajnesh's perspective, the symbols made of earth is more convenient and less problematic, fire is the most suitable symbol for contemplation of Brahman. Why? As Sushrut mentioned, it is a symbol of purity. Okay, that is a very, very important point. Let's think about it a bit more. So if you take water, is water pure? Yeah, you can have pure water. And with pure water, you can purify a lot of things. After all, we wash our clothes and our bodies with water. But also think about the reverse problem. If you take a bit of a mud and throw it in water, the water gets dirty. Okay, then if you look at earth is not considered as very pure in that sense. Because if you have mud, you put your feet onto it, your feet gets dirty. Yeah. So in that sense, earth is not the purest. Whereas our Rishi's view is fire is the symbol of purity. Yeah. Why? Because you cannot contaminate fire. So that is a very mundane example, but actually it gives you a deep philosophical idea. Remember, this is a code, right? You need to understand through those symbols, what is it that I can understand using that symbol about the Supreme Being? So when I look at fire, what is it that I'm going to understand about the Supreme Being? That it is a symbol of purity. Sat, yeah, Satyam, Sat. Is the first name of the Supreme, right? Is one of the most important names, is Satyam. Yeah, I've got a few verses here to remind ourselves. Brahma vidapnoti param tadesha abhyukta satyam jnanam anantam brahma. Gita, om tat sat iti nirdeshaha sat. Ishwaraha paramaha krishnaha satchitananda vigraha sat. Vishnu Sahasranama, there is a very beautiful verse. Pavitranam pavitram yo mangalanam cha mangalam. So that is what Vishnu has celebrated in Vishnu Sahasranama as Pavitranam pavitram. He is, this entity is the purest of the pure. Okay. And Sat actually is Nirdushta, which means no defects, which means very pure. So the literal meaning of Sat or Satyam is not truth. Sat means Nirdushta, which means defectless, which means pure. Yeah, and that is what Vishnu Sahasranama is telling us. Pavitranam pavitram yo mangalanam cha mangalam. Okay, so that is the first quality of the Supreme, is purity. So when I look at the five Panchabhutas I have in front of me, which among the five Panchabhutas will actually give me that idea of purity of the Supreme? That is fire. Okay, the next one is light and knowledge. Okay. This one is Jyotisham Jyotihi. This Upanishads talk about Brahman as Jyotisham Jyotihi. And of course, we have this Gita 15:12. So I'm going to invite one of you to recite the Gita 15:12. So who wants to go for this, please? Pragnesh, yes, go for it.
Yatadityagatam tejo jagat basayate kilam yakchandramasi yakchagno taktejo vidibhamakam.
Beautiful. So Krishna has categorically said, the light of the sun, the light of the moon, the light of the lightning, the light of fire, everything comes because I am behind that. I am the light of the light. Yad aditya gatam tejo jagat basayate akhilam yachandramasi yachagno tat tejo viddi mamakam. So that light there is not just brightness. Light there has so many connotations. Light there means what? That which is full of knowledge. That which is full of knowledge is light. So this one is Sarvajna. And that which is full of Ananda is also knowledge. This is Sarva. This is called infinite bliss. This is called infinite knowledge. This entity called Brahman. Yeah. So that is a key concept. So Mundaka again says, yes, Sarvajna Sarvavid. And because this chap is Sarvajna, he is able to create the universe. And that is why Vedanta Sutra gives a definition of Brahman as Janmadyasya Yataha. Yeah. So that light and knowledge. So when you look at fire, that there is this light that comes out of the fire, right? So that should remind you that, you know, there is this Brahman that is who's pervading the fire. He is of the nature of light and knowledge. Yeah, and he removes darkness. How? When we know about him, he removes the ignorance that we have about him. And once we know that there is the Supreme Being who is our Antaryamin, he removes all fears. When you know you have a companion who is going to provide, protect you always, you will never have fear. Yeah, light pervades the space it occupies. This is an interesting idea here. I've just got a matchstick and I've got some campfire here in the night. Yeah. So when you have light, it pervades everywhere. And in that process, it gives brightness. But there is this concept of pervasion. Pervasion means all pervasive. So again, light, when you think about fire, you will think about this supreme entity who is pervaded everywhere. That is why he's called what? Brahman. Brihantohi asmin gunaha iti Brahman. That which has pervaded everywhere in time, space and gunas is Brahman. So again, you get that idea. So these are important concepts as to why our Vedic rishis actually felt that contemplation on the Supreme through fire is very auspicious. Not because he is sitting inside the fire, he is also sitting in all other entities, but that fire will remind you. For the upasaka, for you and me who do that havan, when we see that fire, it should remind us that I am contemplating on that Brahman, who is a symbol of purity. I am contemplating on that Brahman, who is Jnanandamaya. I am contemplating on that Brahman, who is all pervasive. Sahasra Shirisha Purushaha, Sahasra Akshaha, Sahasra Path. Very first lines of Purusha Shukta, right? We have done this before, and Purusha Shukta is the essence of Vedic philosophy. And the very first line is only talking about this. That this guy is all knowledgeable, he is a Sarvakarta, he is everywhere, etc. And our Vedic rishis are so clever, and they just identified and discovered a symbol that will actually remind us of all this in fire. Okay, that is why fire is the most suitable symbol for contemplation of Brahman, and many Hindu temples, both in India and also in the UK and elsewhere, they do offer this havan service for devotees who come there. So whenever there is that havan facilities available, please make use of this, do your havans. But when you do your havan, contemplate on that fire this way. Yeah, then your havan sacrifice becomes more meaningful. So then it becomes jnana kanda. If you don't do that, then it will remain as karma kanda and will not serve you any great purpose for liberation, which is what Nachiketa is asking. So that is why in the Vedic times, Agnihotra was a must in the Vedic times. That is your own small fire sacrifice as a grihastha in your house 3 times daily. Okay, that is Agnihotra. Now that should all give you the clue as to why Hindus cremate. Okay, so who is going to take this, although it's a painful question, it's got deep philosophy attached to it. Why do Hindus offer their dead to fire? Who is going to take this on?
I can take it on, Madhu. You've already explained this in one of your previous lectures. So we are the last, it is the last ahuti and the last sacrifice.
Wonderful, Devalji. That's absolutely right. Because fire is such a symbol of purity and Brahman. When we have done our karma and we have used this sadhana sharira and we have done a lot of achievements in our 100 years of life, as the last ahuti, because you have done Agnihotra 3 times a day. You have done Agnihotra 3 times a day for 100 years. And then after you are dead, your body is also given as the ahuti. And that is why we cremate. Yeah, there are, of course, all the environmental, etc. there. But this is the philosophy behind as to why Hindus create and why fire is the most suitable symbol for contemplation of Brahman. Although idols or deities, you want to call them, made of earth, are more practical. When it comes to deeper philosophy, fire is the ultimate symbol for contemplation of Brahman. And that is why Nachiketa is asking this. Yeah. Sahatvam agnim swargyam adyeshi mrityoho. And again, I showed this to you before. Is this Agni material Agni, Pradana Agni, Kala Agni, Prana Agni, Chaturmukha, Agni Durga, Agni Narayana? Or is this Agni that Nachiketa is talking about, Pradana Agni's children? Pradana Agni has got 3 children, Suchi, Pavamana, and Pavaka. Suchi, Pavamana, and Pavaka have got 15 children. So when you put them all together, you talk about 49 Agni Devatas in Vedic pantheon. The primary one is the 15th rank in the Vedic pantheon, the Pradana Agni. So which Agni is our friend Nachiketa is asking Yama? So this is something we need to think about very carefully. And again, we have done this very briefly before. This, I wanted to remind you, yad agnihi rohitam rupam tat tejas rupam yad chuklam tad apam yad krishnam tad annam asya agadayad agnitvam vacharambana vikaro namadeyam trini rupani iti eva satyam. We have done this verse in Chandogya Upanishad chapter 6 that talk about these chaps, Kala Agni, Prana Agni, Agni Durga, and then Agni Narayana. It talks about this. Yeah, so go back and revise that particular section. So the Agni that Nachiketa is talking about, because he's saying, Yama, you know about that Agni very well. Okay, so which Agni will Yama know very well? To understand that, you need to know, go to the etymology of the word Agni. Yeah, and we have done this before. Agni, this is the beauty of Sanskrit again. So fire, when I, in English, I say fire. What meaning does it give? Nothing. It just, you know, it talks about a burning thing, something, the flames, and you say fire. That is what an English fire is. Whereas in Sanskrit, when I say Agni, this word, damn, it means so many other things in Sanskrit. So that is why the etymology of Agni becomes interesting. So you split it open, A, Gha plus Ni. Agni Shabdo, Ayam Agra Eva, Abhi Pujyatam. Agrayatvam, Agranetrutvam, Attim, Anganga Netrutam. So this is the etymology. So I'll take you through this very briefly. So Agni can be separated into Agre Niyati, the first to be adored or worshipped. Agrayatvad, the first and the foremost of all. Why? Brahmava Idamagra Asid. Before this creation was there, who was that person in Pralaya who was there? That Agni. Agrayatvad, first and the foremost of all. Agre Nayati, the prime mover of all creation. Attim, the devourer of all. He who destroys the universe and eats it at the end in Pralaya. He is called Attim. Attim and Agnim are similar. Angam Nayati, he who is the activator of bodies of all. Then Agam Nayati, activator of all, or else they will remain inert. So that's interesting. So Gha, so you, if you look at Agni, when you look at that Agni, Gam and A, okay, Gam is Gamayati, that which goes. Agha means that which does not move. Ni means Niyati. So that which gives volition to something that is very inert is Agni. So in the grossest sense, when you put water and you put fire underneath it, what happens? The water bubbles, isn't it, when it boils, because it's given volition. That is the grossest way of looking at it. But in a deep philosophical sense, Agre Niyati, Agrayatva, Agre Nayati, Attim, Angam Nayati, Agam Nayati. That is why it is called Agni. Okay, it is not just fire. So when people say our rishis of Sanatana Dharma were nature worshippers and they worship fire, I really pity those souls who talk like that. That is not the language of the rishis. When rishi talks about Agni, when rishi talks about Vidyut, when rishi talks about anything else, he is not a nature worshipper. He is actually giving, there are etymologies for these words that denote the supreme being. Yeah, I just wish that these fellows, both in the university sector and other places, who write rubbish transliteration, actually understand the Vedic philosophy properly when they talk about Agni. Because the word Agni has got deep etymological and philosophical and spiritual content, you know, connotations for practitioners of Sanatana Dharma. And that is why the very first verse, we all know of Rig Veda, right? The very first sukta is Agni Sukta. And how does it start? Agni Mile Purohitam Yajnasya Devam Rutvijam Hotaram Ratnadatamam. Agnim. It starts as Agni. This Narayana is Agni. And I am going to worship him. That is how the Agni Sukta starts. And it is this Agni of Agni Sukta of Rig Veda that Nachiketa is saying, you know that Agni quite well. This fellow who does all these six different things, that fellow who is Brahman himself, you know him very well. Adyeshi means knows very well. Murtyoho means Yama. So you know that Agni, who is the one who will give us Swargya. Swarga means what? Eternal bliss. So please teach me about that. So I hope this makes sense. And, you know, that is the beauty of reading our Upanishads. Rather than skimming through the surface, once we start thinking and contemplating more, that's when the philosophy comes out. After all, Vedas are called what? Chadayanti iti Chandamsi. That means that which should be broken open to understand the philosophy rather than skimming the surface. And hopefully with God's grace, that's what we have been doing for the past 2 years. And hopefully we'll continue doing our Upanishad Chintana in that spirit. Okay. So my talk on fire would not be complete without me talking about fire in other religions. Okay. This is important concept. It is the fire as a supreme form of worship is not just for the followers of Sanatana Dharma, but actually this fire was considered as a supreme form of worship by many ancient religions and philosophies. Yeah. When I mean very ancient religions and philosophies, I've taken two examples. I've taken Zoroastrianism and I've taken Judaism. And I just want to remind, and I hope you will find this interesting. And I've got a slightly out of context slide here, but I'll try and bring it all together over the next 5-10 minutes. Okay. Fire in other religions, Zoroastrianism, they worship fire. Just like Sanatana Dharma, Zoroastrians or Parsis worship fire. Okay. So their prophet, as you know, is Zarathustra. And their supreme deity is called Ahura Mazda. So Google it, Wikipedia it, or read any books. Okay. And their one of the sacred books, I don't know how to say this, is a Hormuz Yesht, something like that. So they have a very important sacred book where the fire worship, that Agni, is described as in that works. So I'll just read it. I found it very interesting when I was doing this research. Tell me then, O pure Ahura Mazda, the names which is thy greatest, best, fairest, and which is the most efficacious for prayer. Ahura Mazda answered thus, my first name is Ahmi, I am, and my 20th name is Ahmi Yad Ahmi Mazdo. I am that I am. Hold on to that idea. I am that I am. Okay. Ahmi in Persian means I am. Okay. And if you go to, so in Zoroastrianism, fire was a major form of worship. Move to Judaism. Okay, we all know about the story of Moses, right? Read that inspirational story of Judaism, Moses, and how he meets his God Yahweh in the fire. So this is all the story in the incident is in Egypt, and there is a bush, and there is a bush fire, and then Moses then meets this Yahweh as a fire. He is in the form of fire and he meets them. And then one of my colleagues is Jew. So we've had quite a lot of discussions around the Torah. And, you know, he brought the scripture to me at work. Believe me, it was part of my SPA. So we were looking at the Torah book. And there is this verse that talks about when that conversation between Moses and Yahweh happens, Moses asks him, so when I go to the Pharaoh and ask them to release all the Israelite slaves, what should I tell him? Who has sent me? What should I say? So in that, this is in Hebrew. I hope I get this right. Ehe, Esher, Ehe, which literally means I am, aham, as go and tell that Pharaoh that I am or aham has sent me to you. Okay. So in Torah, this fire is called Aham Ehe Ehe. Aham is the most secret, sacred, one among the seven names of God in our Torah scripture. So hold on to those ideas. So then the question here is, who is this Aham that has been described as a fire in Judaism? And who is that Ahmi that has been described by Zarathustra in Zoroastrianism? To understand this deep level question, you have to go to Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. You have to go to Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, Avyakrita Brahmanam, and the famous text of Aham Brahmasmi. Okay, we have dealt with this very briefly before. So I don't want to go to the verses, but all that I want to tell you here is, Aham and Brahma and Asmi of Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, for God's sake, it does not mean that I am Brahman. Yeah, I sincerely submit this to this audience. It really does not mean I am Brahman. What it actually means is that ancient Vedic philosophy, which inspired other religions such as Zoroastrianism, and probably there was some kind of commonality of thinking at that point of Judaism, Zoroastrian, because Judaism says I am or Aham is a sacred name of God. Ahmi. Ahmi is Asmi in Sanskrit. That is as name of God. So Aham, Brahma, and Asmi, these are all names of the Supreme. It does not, for God's sake, mean I am God. Yeah, I just want to burst that bubble because we need deep philosophies. You know, just viewing this as I am God is very, very shallow philosophy with very shallow scriptural understanding. What we need to do is, we need to do comparative analysis, comparative studies of ancient scriptures, and then understand what that Aham and Brahma and Asmi mean. Asmi, for example, means Sarvada Asti Iti Meyam. Aham means Aheyatvat Aham Nama, which means that which is undiscardable is Aham. So when Zarathustra says Ahmi, what it means is Sarvada Asti Iti Meyam. I always exist as infinitely knowledge is blissful, is what that Brahman always knows. There was never a point he did not know that he is all perfect. That is the meaning of asmi. Aham means, as when Yahweh said, I am aham, it means I am undiscardable as an antaryamin in all the jivas. So the meaning of aham brahmasmi, there is undiscardable one, always fully conscious of its own being and perfection. Okay. So I find this very interesting from a phonetics perspective. Look at the Sanskrit word, aheya. Aheya is the root word for aham. Look at the Hebrew, ehye. They sound very similar, aheya and ehye. Look at asmi of Sanskrit. Look at ahmi of Persian. They all look the same. They all sound the same. If all these religions are saying, I am is a secret name of God, how can aham brahmasmi mean that I am God? It just begs belief. But anyway, it just gives me an opportunity to put another view forward so that you can think about it. Why do they say this and why is it relevant to our discussion? Because that aham is Agni Narayana. Why? Gita 15th chapter, 14th verse. What does it say? Aham Vaishvanaro Bhutva Praninam Deham Ashritaha. So that word, aham vaishvanaraha, is not an ordinary word in the Gita. When you understand all this and the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, then you know why Vedavyasa actually put that word aham. My name is aham. I am the fire. My name is aham. I am the fire. My name is aham. I am the fahar. These are all the unified thoughts of all philosophies that somehow we are not looking at it that way, but just seeing superficial senses and building some airy fairy castles with no foundations in it. So I hope you find this interesting about this aham and Vaishwanaraha and fire. Look at our friends in the church. They light candles. Why do they light candles? Because fire in Christianity is also symbol of knowledge, symbol of, you know, the supreme being. I've got a picture of Udupi Krishna temple where Mangalarti is going on and there is light all over the place. So when we go to our Hindu temples and we look at fire, we should be reminded of the supreme qualities of Brahman. I've got Madurai Kamakshi temple here with fully lit. And that is again to remind us that the supreme Brahman is full of knowledge. He is the purest. He is Jnanandamaya, etc. And in Deepavali or any other day, every day in your puja room, when you light the candles or deepas, remind yourself about that Agni and what is the etymology of the Agni and so on. Because this is what our friend Nachiketa is asking, okay? When he says, Satvam Agnim Swargyam Adyeshi Mrityoho Prabruhi Tvam Shraddhadanaya Mahyam. So I got a few more slides. I thought I will actually skim through this, but the discussions have taken a bit long. So let's see how it goes for the next 10-15 minutes. So we have dealt with Agnim so far. And I had to spend 30-40 minutes to give you the philosophy of Agni as a background, because in the next several vallis, Yama is going to be talking about this Agni. He is going to talk only about this Agni. So unless we understand this Agni to start with, we will not be able to appreciate. And that's the reason why I took some effort and time to explain who this Agni is. So Agni is Agni Narayana equals Vishnu equals Brahman. Okay, so what did our friend Nachiketa says? You know that Agni, Adyeshi, very well. Prabruhi, again, Prabruhi means Pra plus Bruhi. Bruhi means tell me. Pra means Prakrishtena Bruhi. That means tell me very well. You tell me very well. Why? I am Shraddhadanaya Mahyam. Okay, I am full of faith and I want to know. Okay, at this point, I want to just pause a minute. It's always well worth reminding ourselves those Gita verses that also pick up the same concepts. Because as I told you before, Katha Upanishad and Gita go hand in hand. We have to read them together. So who is going to take this verse? 439.
Madhu?
Go for it, Neetaji.
Shraddhavan labhate jnanam tatparasanyatendriyah jnanam labdhva param shantim achirenadhigacchati.
Thank you, Neetaji. Very, very beautifully recited. Shraddhavan labhate jnanam. He who has faith is the one who will actually have the knowledge. And that's the reason why Nachiketa says, look, I've got faith. Shraddhadanaya mahyam. You know him very well. Explain to me very well. Who is that person? Swargaloka amrutatvam bhajante yetad dvitiyena varena vrune varena. Okay. So that fellow, that Agni Narayana, who will not only take me to Swargya, the temporary Swarga, but after that, he will actually take me to the permanent Swarga, which is called Amrutatvam. So I want to know about them, about that person. So the Amrutatvam there then evolves, the text evolves, Amrutatvam reminding this Swargaloka, that one Swargaloka is temporary Swargaloka, but that there is this Swargaloka Amrutatvam, which is the permanent Swargaloka, which is where our friend Nachiketa is requesting Yama to teach so that he can go there. So I always like our birds, right? So in this bird, when we say Dvasuparna, Sayuja, Sakaya, Samana, Vriksham, Parishashva, Jate, we have done this endlessly, where there is this Brahman bird, there is this Jiva bird, there is actually another bird, which is Yama, who is actually teaching this bird so that he can go to this Brahman. And Mundaka Upanishad in the third chapter, this whole thing is described very well. Most of you are now familiar with this. I'll just finish off with the last one. Yata Nadyaha Syandamanaha. How do that happen? Te paranta lokeshu parantakale param amrutam parim uchayanti sarve. You go to Satyaloka, stay with Chaturmukha Brahma, and then cross over to the Amrutatvam. So when you sit, read with Mundaka, the Gita, and what Nachiketa is asking, there is perfect samanvaya there. There is no confusion. Nobody is contradicting another person. So basically, what Nachiketa is saying, I want that eternal salvation, not what my dad was seeking, which is just do a Vishwajit Yajna and go to temporary, you know, temporary Swargaloka and then come back again. I don't want that. I want to cross and go to the other side. So when our Nachiketa has asked this huge question, then Yama now starts the conversation. So that was the second vara or boon. The Nachiketa asks Yama, he says, I want to know about that Agni. I want to know about that Agni sacrifice that will actually let me cross the material plane and then go to the other side. So our Yama is really very, very happy when he hears this from Nachiketa. Because there is a very famous verse in Chandogya Upanishad. Yadeva vidyaya karoti shraddaya upanishadaha tadeva viravattaram bhavati. So yadeva vidyaya karoti is an important statement of Chandogya. When you do some rituals, when you do anything, do with proper knowledge, do with correct knowledge of why you are doing, then it becomes purposeful, then you become viravattaram bhavati. Okay. So Yama is very happy that this fellow wants to know the ultimate truths of all these things. So he then starts explaining. I don't know how much time we will have. I want to do some introduction to the number 360 and then we'll close it about 4:15, 4:20 we'll close it. We got about 10-15 minutes. Okay, so the very first verse, Yama immediately says, Prate bravimi tadume nibodha swargyam agnim nachiketaha prajanan ananta lokaptim ato pratishtam viddhi tvam yetam nihitam guhayam lokadim agnim tamuvacha tasmai ya ishtakaha yavatirva yatava. So one thing I want to say is I've kind of put those red boxes and I've come to green boxes. The reason being, the classic rendering of these verses is somewhere in the last 2,000 or 3,000 years, some of these verses have moved up and down. So for you to get the logical sequence of thought, you need to skip and come back to some of the verses. Okay. So once he has said, Ya ishtakaha yavatirva yatava, then you have to go to this verse. Trinachiketaha tribiretya sandhim trikarma krit tarati janma mrityuhu brahma jagnam devam idyam viditva nityayem imam shantim atyantameti trinachiketaha trayametad viditva ya evam vidvan chinute nachiketam sa mrityupashan purataha pranodya shokatigo modate swargaloke. So these words, these lines, it's probably is going to take us 2 or 3 weeks to actually to understand the deep knowledge that has been squeezed by Kata Rishi when he has seen these mantras, that so much knowledge is knowledge and philosophy of Sanata Dharma is enclosed in this. So we'll try and break it open and understand. And then of course, then the 5, 6 and 7 is much more easier. So the philosophy is in this, okay? So let's make a pravesha. So pra means, look at this particular chapter. There are a lot of pras here. Pra te, pra janan, pra tishtam. Okay, so pra means prakrishta. Prakrishta means very nice. Yeah, very beautiful. Yeah, so very elevated, the best form. So all those superlatives is what prakrishta is, pra there. So so Yama says, pra te bravimi tadu me nibodha. So I know about that Agni very well. Listen to me very well. Okay. Swargyam Agnim. So I know about that Swargyam Agnim, Nachiketaha. Prajanan. So that Prajanan means too. Prajanan means, Janan means who knows this Agni. Janan means Jana. We say Jana, right? Jana means somebody who knows. Prajana means Prakrishta Jana. He who knows very well. Okay. He says, Nachiketa, I know this very well about this Swargyam Agnim. I'll tell you in detail. At the same time, you are also Prajanan. You are asking for, you know, ultimate truth. So you're a very clever boy. So I will explain to you. Okay, so what happens? What is the benefit? So before he goes into the details of this Agni, he says, what is the benefit of knowing this? Ananta lokaptim ato pratishtam. Okay, this is important. Again, this beauty is in the detail. So ananta loka aptim ato pratishtam. So you break it open. So this word becomes ananta plus loka. So ananta loka. Okay, so ananta means what? Infinite. Loka means place. So that place, that liberated place is infinite. So that the scriptures talk about this moksha, that place has got no end. It is an infinite place where you have infinite jivas in moksha experiencing their own inner bliss in jnana. So that is anantaloka. Apti means you attain. Okay, so you will attain that anantaloka. Pratishta means you will stay there. You will never come back. Once you go to that place, you don't come back. Last sutra of Brahma Sutra, what does it say? Anavruttir Shabdat, Anavruttir Shabdat. So when Vedavyasa says Anavruttir Shabdat, Shabda means Veda, Anavritti means no return, he's talking about, say, this verse, Ananta Loka Aptim Pratishtam, you stay there, you will not come back. Okay. And at the same time, how do you reach that place? The person who sheds his grace and makes you reach that place is also called Ananta Lokapti. So in the classic rendering of scriptures, Ananta Lokapti is a name of Vishnu. Okay. Pratishtam, he is there. He is there in the Vaikuntha as Ananta Lokapti, and you are going to join him. And where, what is that place? Ananta Loka Apti Pratishtam. So it gives you so many different meanings there. So vidhim tvam yetam nihitam guhayam. So this is a very, very important verse. So here Agni is our Yama is saying, Nachiketa, look, when you know about that Agni, you will cross the material world and you will go to the transempirical world. But you know what, actually you don't have to be, yes, you need to work hard to go to that place, but that Supreme Brahman is all pervasive, right? And he then immediately says, he's not just that Ananta Loka, he's not just there, he's actually right inside your heart. With the Tvam Yetam Nihitam Guhayam. So what that Yama is saying is, again, it is a very, very key verse. He says, search for that Agni Narayana inside you. He is that Agni Narayana is inside you as your Antaryamin. So that gives you that concept of Atma and Antaratma. Okay. So Atma, we know, has got various meanings. It can mean your body, it can mean your mind, it can mean your intellect, it can mean the Jiva, or it can mean the Paramatma inside the Jiva. Okay. So in the Paramamukhya Vritti, Atma essentially means the Supreme Being. And of course, it has other meanings. It depends on the context. So Atma is that has pervaded your body. Okay. But where is the Jiva? Jiva is inside that hole, isn't it, in the thymus, in that cave in the thymus is where the Jiva is described to be. And inside the Jiva is, inside the scripture says the Jiva also has got a heart. And inside that heart is this Antaryami, which is the Paramatma. Okay, so Atma and Paramatma, this Antaratma is the Agni. Narayana, Nihitam Guhayam. When he talks about this Nihitam Guhayam, it not only means Antaratma, who is in your material heart, but it also means that Antaratma, who is inside the Jiva itself. Okay, so I just want to request maybe 1% to take on these three key verses of Gita, 13, 18, 15, 14, and 15, 15, which actually tells us about this. So who wants to do that, please? Anybody? Neeta ji? Oh, Pragnesh, go for it.
Well, I would like to go for 15, 14, and 15.
Okay, go for it.
Aham Vaishvanaro Bhutva Praninam Dehamasita Prana Parasaba Yukta Pachamyanam Chaturvidam.
Yeah.
And then Sarvashachayam Radhishanivisto.
Thank you, Pragneshi. So in these key verses in chapter 15, he said, aham vaishwanaro bhutva praninam deham ashritaha. So deha there has so many meanings. Deha means sandeha. Sandeha means the middle portion of the heart, middle portion of the body. Middle portion of the body is where the heart is. So I am inside as aham as vaishwanaraha. That is one. And then he is also in the subsequent verse, he clarifies what that means. Hridi sannivishtaha. I am in that cave of the heart. Yeah. And similarly, Hridi Sarvasya Vishtitam in 13 and 18. So Krishna has very, very clearly said that he's here. I'm here, mate. I'm here. Don't go and search for me in the temples. And my guru always says, don't waste your time searching in the temples. Yes, it is good for a Sunday's day out, but searching for God inside the temple will only take you so much. You have to search for the God within yourself. Yeah, and that is what Yama is saying, Nachiketa, Viddi Tvam Yetam Nihitam Guhayam. This Agni Narayana, yes, he is in moksha, but he is also inside you. So that is a key verse there, Nihitam Guhayam. And then he says, Lokadim Agnim Tamuvacha Tasmai Ya Ishtakaha Yavatirva Yatava. Okay, so this is too big a topic to discuss. So I'm going to close the discussion here, just taking one half of this verse. Lokadim agnim tamuvacha tasmai. So that agni is what Yama then qualifies more. Who is that agni? Lokadim agnim. So what does that mean? Loka plus adim plus agnim. So what is loka plus adim? So it has several meanings there. Loka and adi. Loka means this material world. Adi means before this material world come into being, who was there before the material being coming in? That is Loka Adim. Okay. And at the same time, Loka Adi means the originator. Loka means he who is the creator of this universe. Janmadyasya Yataha. So when Yama says Loka Adi Magnim, he is directly again reminding us. This Agni is not Pavaka. He is not this ordinary fire god. It is the supreme being himself, the Agni Narayana, who is being described here. Lokadim Agnim. Okay. So there are so many verses that I have extracted both in the Gita as well as in Chandogya Upanishad and Taittiriya Upanishad that actually talk to us about the creatorship of the supreme, which is what Yama is celebrating as Lokadim Agnim. Yeah, so I will do the Upanishad. Somebody be ready for reciting chapter 10:6, please. Sadeva Somya Idamagra Asit Ekameva Advitiyam. We did that in Chandogya Upanishad. Sadeva Somya Idam Agre Asit. Before creation, who was there? That is that Advitiyam. And that is the same Yama is talking as Loka Adi Magnim. Taittiriya Upanishad. Yato va imani bhutani jayante yena jatani jivanti yat prayanti abhisam vishanti tad vijignasasva tad brahmeti. So that person who is a creator is called Brahman. Okay. That is the same that Yama is talking about, Lokadim Agnim. Okay. And can I request, invite one of you to recite chapter 10, 6th verse, please. Again, a very important verse of Gita. Who wants to take that? Neeta ji, go for it.
Aham sarvasya prabhavo mattas sarvam pravartate iti matva bhajante maam buddha bhava samanvitaha.
Beautiful. So that's a great verse. Aham sarvasya prabhavo mattah sarvam pravartate. Every damn thing of existence emanates from me. Okay. So and that is what the lokadi magnim is. Yeah. So when you look at all these evidences, this is how we have been taught to study the scriptures, not in isolation, but actually that is the prasthana traya, right? You have sutra prasthana, Gita prasthana, and Upanishad prasthana, and I have arranged them in the same order to understand what is it that Yama is talking to Nachiketa. This lokadi magnim is Agni Narayana. Yeah. So then the question is, what did he teach about that Agni sacrifice? So you have the fire and you have the bricks around it, isn't it? Now it becomes amazing philosophy that Yama talks about. And he says, Ya Ishtakaha, Yavatirva, and Yatava. He taught all this. What did he teach Nachiketa? Ya Ishtakaha, what types of bricks are used around the kunda? Yavatirva, how many bricks are used? Yatava, and how do you contemplate these bricks? And how do you contemplate the bricks? And then you are the fire in between. How do you contemplate all this? Is what Yama explained to Nachiketa. That's what the Upanishad says. It does not give you explanation as to the details of it. What types of bricks, how many bricks, how to contemplate, and so on. And here I wanted to just introduce this concept. Secret knowledge of the Upanishad is conveyed only through a guru. You cannot find some of this in transliterations of books. If you go to proper Gurukula, you learn from a guru, then they will explain as to what that Ishtakaha, Yavatirva, and Yatava, because that is deepest levels of philosophy with mathematics attached to it and physics and astronomy attached to it. You will be surprised about how much of physiology, how much of astronomy has gone into this particular verse. So what is the deeper philosophy of the Agni Kunda? A kunda needs a fixed number of certain type of bricks laid in a certain fashion to facilitate contemplation. So what not Yama is going to be talking to us in the next class is, he'll talk about three types of kunda. Remember in Kataka Upanishad, everything is in three. Yeah, lot of threes will come in. So he'll talk about the kunda of fire sacrifice, the kunda of pinda. In our own body, what is that kunda? And in the Kala Namaka Paramatma, in this whole universe, in our solar system, when there is the sun, which is the fire, and there is the kunda, which is the time. So how do you relate kunda, pinda, and kala? And then how do you contemplate on the supreme? So that is what Yama is going to be teaching us in the next class. Talking about these three aspects, kunda, pinda, and kala, as to how you contemplate on this lokadi magnim. Okay, so hopefully we'll touch upon this. It's too much information I've got here. So we will take that next week. On that note, I think we have well into our discussions today. So I'll close there. Krishna pranamastu. And if anybody wants to contribute, discuss, bring about any questions, that'll be good. Thank you very much for listening. Pragnesh, go for it.
I know you explained very well the difference between earth and fire in the rituals, but I have a question. There is a lot of emphasis on Abhisheka also, where we use water or other fluid. Any elaboration on that aspect, please?
Yeah, so this whole concept of temple worship and all the procedures that you do for temple worship and so on, Pragneshti, I'm sure there is a whole lot of discussions to be had. The Abhisheka, for example. So the way I would see it is, we clean our bodies, right? We every day have, this is a very mundane explanation I have. I'm sure there is a deeper levels of philosophies there. It's every day I have a bath and I clean myself so that I become pure. So it is just that kind of a relationship with the Supreme. When I am pure, when I am cleaning and I am pure, God, I've done puja the previous day and today I want to do all this and keep you pure and then I want to dress you up again. And so it's having that kind of relationship with the Supreme is the idea that I would get. And it is just your mark of respect to the Supreme that you want to keep him in the best condition, that particular deity that you're contemplating on, that you want to keep him at the best conditions. And also for people who watch that, it's pleasing to their eyes. And again, when it is pleasing to their eyes, you remind yourself, when it is pleasing, it gives you a bit of ananda, right? And then you think about what that Supreme Being is, the highest abode of all the anandas. So that is how you contemplate on this, is my understanding. I don't know if anybody else has any views. Pragnesh, maybe you want to also explain a bit further on that.
I had just a question. No, I don't have any explanation, but I may want to look into it sometime.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, but I know folks have mentioned maybe we should get our purohits of temples who do all these rituals to actually explain to us. Yeah, and when they explain to us, it becomes more interesting rather than just sitting there and, you know, we are holding our hands and standing there. It's helpful to some extent, but to understand this will be even more interesting. And I'm sure we'll fix some sessions. Yeah.
Namaskar, Masudanji. I have a small, the faith that we have on the, when we go to, as you said, to the Krishna temple, the faith that you have towards the Lord, is that faith a kind of Agni that is there? That's what we should meditate on after coming back. This faith, the energy and Agni, is it the same? Because, yeah.
Sure. The faith and the energy, you could say they're all they're all similar or the same. It depends on your anusandhana, how you kind of approach that. So the energy is an interesting point, Pratibhaji. For example, we will have, maybe in the next class we'll deal with this when we talk about nadis. When we talk about nadis, energy centers, pranic energy, pranic channels within the body, and so on. So where in each, if there are 72,000 nadis or energy centers, then there are 72,000 forms of the Supreme there. So those are all the contemplations. So in that sense, yes, when you think about that energy, think about that Agni Narayana.
Yeah, I was just thinking, even when Vadiraja Swami, he saw that Tirupati, that mountain, that hill, he never saw it as a mountain. He saw it as a saligrama, the entire hill. He saw it as a saligrama and he walked with his knees, no? So yeah, something is there, even in that outside, that energy is there. And maybe that's what is you need to contemplate. And finally, that Agni Narayana
Very nicely put, Pratibhaji. Again, it is the anusandhana or the spirit in which you go and worship, rather than just going to the temple and putting some undi and say, look, I have to pass this exam. It is just not going to work. That's what our Uddalaka did. So that's why it didn't work for him. Yeah. Devalji, you got your hands raised.
Sorry, I have a slightly different question. So in your, I think second slide or something, when he's asking a question, he uses two words for fear, bhayam and bibheti.
Yeah.
And I'm just wondering, is it just to enrich the language by using different adjectives, or do they have specific meaning? Because you seem to imply that certain words are used.
Yeah. We extremely well put, Deval, again. Yes, I'm sure they have other meanings, but with my limited understanding of it, when said na bayam kinchanasti, and then na jaraya bibeti, the bibeti, in that context, again, is fear. But I think there must be different types of fears that is being described there. So what the different types of fears, maybe let me do some homework and try and see why those two different words are used there to bring different types of fear, I'm sure. But I'll explain, I'll try and do my homework. Thanks for prompting me for that. You're absolutely right. Words are not put in our scriptures just like that. They have a meaning and have a relevance. Yeah, so I'll find out and let you know. Thanks.
Okay. Thanks.
Excellent. So I think we are done for today. So shall I get Pragnesh ji to take us through Om today, please?
Thank you.
So thank you, everyone. So just to remind you, next week we have Geeta Jayanti celebrations. And that's going to be a fantastic program. So it's going to be, as usual, intercontinental program. There is a variety program that has been organized, including an external speaker from India who is going to talk to us about Gita. There are kids performing, providing cultural entertainment and everything about Gita. Then we have our usual five continents, five families reciting chapter 15. So we got quite, and then bhajans, we got some surprise talents coming up as well next week. And we got a young person who is going to compare the show. Shilpa from Dubai is going to compare the whole show for us next Sunday. So I'll send the invite out tomorrow once the itinerary is confirmed. Please share it with friends and family. The more join us, the merrier for next Sunday. So it's not some hardcore philosophy. We are going to be celebrating Krishna's Bhagavad Gita. As you know, the Gita Jayanti is this Tuesday. So please do, if you have your Gita book, do some pujas to it on Tuesday and read some verses. And on Sunday, we're going to have an amazing program. So look forward to seeing you all on Sunday. And we'll close today's session on that note. Yeah, thank you everyone for joining. Bye now.
Thanks, Mother.